If you enjoy listening to The Edge, support them by subscribing to The Edge on iTunes, Stitcher, and you can listen through the iHeartRadio app. Get busy listening.
This is The Edge.
The advantage, it means.
Hey, look, I just spit on me for no reason.
That's horrible.
Is there some comfort in uncertainty, do you think?
You're a degenerate.
Because Australian shepherds need action.
Wow.
Yeah.
This is The Edge.
That's a self-loathing term that I use.
Oh, got it.
Welcome to the show. I am Mark. Great episode with a legendary musical performer named Chuck Negron. He was one of the founding members of a band called Three Dog Night. Only one of the most successful bands in history. We said they sold 60 million records, but they may have sold 90 million records, according to a source of mine in the record industry. But regardless, they helped shape a generation of music. The late 60s and early to mid 70s, Three Dog Night was on the radio all the time. And the culture of sex, drugs, and rock and roll, the changing culture of the 60s into 70s, was a really intense one and important one. And Chuck Negron was sort of the poster child for part of it. And we talk about being part of that success. We also talk about the sex, drugs, and rock and roll part. In fact, there's a sex story. I don't think it's too super explicit. We try to keep everything kind of not super explicit. But we do address it later in the program. We talk about LSD, and we talk about the fact that Chuck, one of the richest and most famous performers on earth at the time, got into drugs, and he lost everything. So the whole Three Dog Night story will follow. We start the show, as we do most episodes, with Michael Shure. We call it the Fast 15. It runs a little longer than 15 today. We'll get into politics and more. We'll do the sexual misconduct roundup of the week, all the people accused of and responding to charges of sexual misconduct, the political implications, what could happen, the state of the GOP tax bill. We talk about President Trump lifting the ban on trophy hunters, bringing the parts of elephants and other big game that they've killed in Africa back into this country. But as we go to air, Trump has now reversed himself and says that he will uphold a government ban on hunters bringing trophies of elephants that were killed in Zimbabwe into the United States pending a further review. So that's kind of in play. Still, we give you a little window on trophy hunting and what it's about. I think it's about 15 minutes into the show. At 20 minutes into the show, we leave politics behind, and I'll give you the lowdown on the most expensive painting ever purchased at auction. Who bought it? How much did they pay? Who else wanted to buy it? How much were they willing to pay? We'll get into all of that with Michael Shure. The other thing that's happening as we go to air is there was a huge oil leak from the Keystone Pipeline in South Dakota. 210,000 gallons of oil leaking. Hey, by the way, when you hear that, 210,000 gallons of oil, that's generally the estimate on behalf of the company. And they tend to play down these leaks. So I wouldn't be at all surprised if it's much more than that. That's a massive spill. It's the largest spill to date in South Dakota. And in days, Nebraska is going to decide on whether the proposed Keystone XL pipeline, the sister project, can move forward. There have been spills and problems with this pipeline already. In April of last year, there was a 17,000 gallon spill. Remember, this pipeline goes 2,600 miles from Alberta, Canada, all the way south to Texas. And this is a pretty new pipeline that they're having problems with. So you can't say, well, it's old and corroded, and this is very hard oil to clean up. So there's going to be more on this story, but I just wanted to mention it was happening as we went to air. Anyway, that's a lowdown on some of the things that are happening, and we'll get into more. Thank you for being here, as I always do. Thank you for the many ways you support us by subscribing and by sharing the podcast. That really helps us grow the audience. If you want to support us financially, of course, there's a PayPal link. You can always click that, and some of you have, and I really appreciate that. And there are Amazon links. When you go into an episode to listen, it'll say shop at Amazon or some reference to Amazon. Click on that, and that's the regular Amazon that you would normally shop on. But because you click through our website, we get a little something of whatever you spend. If you're listening on iTunes or iHeartRadio, our website is edge-show.com, edge-show.com. That's where you'll find the Amazon links. And again, it's a great way to support us. A lot of people shopping at the holidays through Amazon. If you're going to do it anyway, this way, by going through edge-show.com, we get a little something, and it helps us pay for our web guy and producers and that kind of thing. Nobody makes any money on this podcast. I don't make a dime. Every dollar that you help us raise in these ways that I've mentioned will stay with the podcast. I make you that promise. And I also make you the promise that we'll never have commercials, but you do have to listen to me beg every week. So thanks for being here. Thanks for all the ways you support us. And now on with the show.
You're listening to The Edge. Join us on the web at edge-show.com.
Time for the Fast 15. Our political expert talks politics and more. He is Michael Shure, everybody.
Hey. Ah! Oh, this is good. God.
Welcome back in the flesh. You called in last episode.
Yeah, I was freezing in a car in Iowa when I was doing that last appearance, which wasn't an appearance, so I didn't get to see all these fine folks.
Well, we appreciate your dedication. We appreciate you being here in person. And we must start with the growing list of people who are involved in sexual harassment of one sort or another. And this, some of these things are you'd call sexual harassment. Some of these things really you'd call sexual assault.
Right. I mean, there's a spectrum of the offensiveness of all of this, with the understanding that all of it's pretty offensive.
That's a very important point, though, because a lot of the stuff's being sort of put in the same bag. I don't think it is.
Right.
It may belong in one big bag, but then within that bag, there should be little other individual bags of degrees of offensiveness.
Right. And even though it doesn't matter to the 34-year-old who has been assaulted or harassed, it is worse when it's a 13 or 14-year-old victim of a man of age.
Exactly. So let's start with Roy Moore, and then I will get to Al Franken. But Roy Moore now, because you mentioned the 14-year-old, he has apparently a pretty well-documented record of harassing these underage women.
Yeah, and as we speak, and I'm not sure that all of them were underage when harassed, but he certainly made efforts. I mean, he called, there's a story that he called a high school principal to get one of the kids on the phone. And so he went through, he called the school to actually contact the girl. This is not just one person. If it was one person and it was true, it would be as offensive as anything. But it's not just one. I mean, they're up to six at least accusers for Roy Moore now.
Well, and then the mall is literally saying that guy can't come around here anymore. The mall?
Remember the mall? From a mall.
So what's the future of Roy Moore now? First of all, why is everybody so concerned with this guy, Roy Moore? Who is he? I mean, meaning what is that Senate seat?
Well, the Senate seat's important because when you have a Senate seat that's locked in as a seat in your party, when the Republican hold on the Senate is fragile at 52-48 now, 51-49 makes a big difference. You saw in the Affordable Care Act, they wouldn't have needed John McCain at that point, if Doug Jones had been there instead of their Strange for that seat. So they care a lot about that. They care about it when it comes to judges, when it comes to issues, when it comes to every kind of initiative that the majority in the Senate wants to put forward. So it's really important in that regard. We care about him because he is a lightning rod and has offended people for a long time. He's been provocative. He was a two-time Supreme Court justice in Alabama who was kicked off the bench because he took a position on a monument to the Ten Commandments.
Because he didn't just take these positions, right, Michael?
He defied the Supreme Court. And he also has said offensive things about homosexuals and about Muslims, about a possible future colleague of his.
Well, he said also gays, they're not going to get married in my state.
Right.
And I'm not going to enforce this new law allowing them to get married.
So he's stridently right-wing. He stridently brings out religion. And then these accusations come along. He's running against a guy in Doug Jones who's not necessarily well-known and I think has run a pretty good campaign considering this is happening. Let's think, before we knew that Roy Moore had these sexual allegations, there was a poll that showed Doug Jones 6 points behind Moore in Alabama. 6 points for a Democrat back in the state of Alabama is unheard of. A Democrat hasn't won statewide there since 1992 for a Senate seat and 2010 for any other office. And so it's unheard of that this would be happening right now. That it is speaks to Doug Jones, who has a good history as a civil rights minded U.S. attorney there. He prosecuted decades later the bombing of the Birmingham church. Bobby Ray Cherry and Thomas Blanton got those guys, 30 years afterwards, long life prison sentences where they died. And so he's got his foot in the right place for Alabama. He's not going to be every liberal Democrat's favorite senator, but they would love to have that vote.
And boy, if Roy Moore wins, then he not only is the senator there from that state, but he'll serve in the legislative body in other ways than just being present on the Senate floor for votes.
No, that's exactly right. And I don't think he's going to be senator for very long, let's speak honestly. He'll serve out the rest of session's terms.
This is an open seat, right?
The Republicans will come up with somebody who is more appealing to the Republicans in Alabama, unless Jones does very well and, that he can ride his momentum into the Senate should he win, in the same way that he did his turn as U.S. attorney with Bobby Frank Cherry and Thomas Blanton being his thing. If he comes to Alabama with an accomplishment, he'll be good.
The other thing that's going on, again, these new stories about Al Franken. I mean, Al being embroiled in his own sexual assault charges. Leanne Tweeden, who's a morning news anchor in Los Angeles.
Who I've never heard of in my life until today.
She was on my show called Guinness Prime Time. She was 22, and she was stunningly beautiful. And she's still
She's a former
beautiful.
Playboy Playmate, right?
She's very attractive. I mean, if you like that kind of thing.
Right.
And he was on a tour with her, a USO tour, and he took a picture, which is clearly a gag picture.
Yeah.
This is one part of it. I'll get to the second part. And the picture showed him with his hands about to grab her breasts.
Yeah, right? As if to grab them, but not touching her.
And looking back at the camera with sort of that lecherous, excited look.
Right. Or a comedic... Ha ha ha. You know, it's Al Franken, so he's a guy who's probably been goofing on things his entire life. So
I took it completely as that.
Yeah. But it's not your daughter, and it's not your wife, and it's not, you know.
No, and I don't mean to invalidate how offended she is at all. In fact, I get it.
I don't think you lose your Senate seat for that. But if the story is true of what she claims, that, you know, he forced in a rehearsal of a kiss for the shtick that they were doing at the USO, you know, entertaining, you know, officers abroad, that he forced a kiss and forced her to rehearse the kiss and then shoved his tongue down her throat, right?
Right.
That, to me, is far more offensive than a goofball comedian. We have to remember, and it doesn't matter, it doesn't take the offense, make it any less, but this is 2006, before he was a senator, before he even announced that he was a candidate. It matters a tiny little bit. If a U.S. senator even does the joke at that point, then it's unacceptable.
That's a great point. I mean, you comport yourself differently when you're a U.S. senator, but the second part, which is what we were talking about, the kiss, the forcible kiss,
yeah.
In the story she tells, he says, well, you know, we should really rehearse a kiss. I mean, like, right. If we're going to do it, we should rehearse it. And that's when he forces his tongue into her mouth. And
again, she's accused him of that, and he has, you know, he'll defend it probably. He says already he doesn't remember it the same way, and he's sorry if he offended her. A lot of people think that his quote-unquote apology or acknowledgement wasn't sufficient. Until he speaks much more about it, it won't be. He's notoriously difficult to get on the record about anything. He's one of the senators, when you're in the halls of Congress, who will not speak to you in the halls of Congress. He'll just rush right by you. So to get him to speak about this will be a challenge. He'll probably have to do it in front of the Ethics Committee. And I think what happens in these cases is you wait for more, right? I mean, typically we've seen, not Roy Moore, you wait for more accusers, because invariably it seems to have happened with every accused person, from Louis C.K. to Anthony Weiner to Roy Moore. It hasn't yet with Al Franken. But if this stands alone, I guess it will somehow help his case. But if other accusers come, it will show a pattern of behavior that's unacceptable.
There was a story that Al Franken, just as we were coming to these microphones, that Al Franken was calling for a committee investigation on his own. Like, he was leading the call for
it. I can't confirm that, but it doesn't surprise me that he would do that. It seems like it would be almost the prudent thing to do. I mean, if you really think you're innocent and you want your day in whatever court it is, kangaroo or otherwise, that's the thing you do. Also, the Ethics Committee is where cases go to die, so he probably thinks, I'll go to the Ethics Committee, everything will be fine.
And Mitch McConnell was quick to call for it.
Of course Mitch McConnell was quick to call for it, but let's talk about the hypocrisy. Mitch McConnell never once, not even a little, remarked about the president's behavior when he was a candidate, about the scores of women, or score and more.
Score plus.
The score plus of women who came out and said that Donald Trump had sexually assaulted them, and a tape that said the things that it said. He allowed his wife to be a member of the president's cabinet, but he can't, you know, he can't countenance the behavior by Franken. No, it's both, right?
Right. The hypocrisy is so naked.
It is so naked. And I think Democrats are and we've already seen it, saying this is unacceptable by Senator Franken. He needs an ethics committee. I think some Democrats will say he probably should step aside. It's good for them to do that politically, and even if it's the right thing to say anyway, right? You know, but politically is how we analyze this stuff, and, you know, fault us for it, but that's what we do. Politically, it's smart. The Democrats don't want to seem as coddling. I think this also guarantees that there will be a woman on the ticket in 2020, no matter whether at the top or bottom of the ticket.
Well, you know this, and there may be a lady or two listening, and I'm not just currying favor with them. I believe women should run everything. I think men are great at building things, but I'm increasingly convinced that we're just a bunch of dicks. And I'm sorry, but now there are women who can be dickish.
Right. Well, anybody can be a dick. I don't think that one gender is more dickish. I think in this arena, men are idiots, you know?
And yeah, I think powerful men.
I'm not saying other men.
Powerful men, Michael, I'm sorry. I think we tend to be a little...
But I mean, haven't we been dumb? I mean, not law-breaking and violating, but haven't we been dumb with women before in our lives? I have been, you know? I mean, I'm sure you have. I mean, I say dumb, like, you know, so, come on, you want to come over? You know, that kind of stuff. It's just, you're stupid. You're an animal.
Yeah.
But I don't think you make the broad... You know, listen, I think they're great men and a ton of unappreciated women. And it would be great to have I wanted a woman to be president now as we sit here. And I think that this... All of what the Democrats are doing and the way they have been around Franken and these other stories indicates to me that they think that it's, you know, that they are taking the side of women in America, and it's a smart thing to do politically, and it's the right thing to do ethically.
Well, maybe it was too broad a generalization.
There are more men who are dicks, that's for sure.
I believe there are two kinds of people in the world, Michael. People who make broad generalizations and people who don't.
Right.
So.
Right. You know what you just did? Never mind.
Quickly, also, the tax bill. What's the status of that?
Tax bill passes the House, and then it goes to the Senate, where it's not going to be met with open arms. Already, Ron Johnson, in a surprise, the Wisconsin Republican, saying who's not up for re-election, has no real, it's weird skin in the game here, says he's opposed to the tax break. Senators really pissed off at Rand Paul for including a repeal of the mandates in the Affordable Care Act as part of this tax bill. It probably won't pass the Senate.
So what happens then?
Well, then they go, these members of Congress, the House can go home and say, we passed it and we can blame the Senate. The senators go home and a lot of them have to say, well, we were careful here because we didn't think what the House gave us was responsible and we don't want to mess with your health care. What the really sort of evolving thing here is the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, whatever you want to call it, has gone from something that Republicans ran against to something that Democrats are running for. And I think that's changed because of the popularity. Look at the results in Maine last week. In Maine, a Medicaid expansion ballot initiative passed with 66% of the vote. If that's the trend in America, this is a done deal.
Additionally, this past week, there were impeachment articles.
Five articles of impeachment brought forth by Representative Steve Cohen of Tennessee. Not the first to do it. Al Green of Houston was the first. Joined this one. A few others also joining this one. Nancy Pelosi wants to be very careful about this. Doesn't want this chatter because she still thinks in swing districts, being for impeachment will hurt at the election. Hard to say. She's been right since Trump took office about everything she's done. But, you know, Steve Cohen is saying, listen, I'm a politician, but I believe that this is the worst president we've ever had. I've lived through Nixon. So on obstruction of justice, on international and domestic emoluments, and two other charges of breaking the Constitution, he has said, it's time.
But of course, and if you haven't heard this episode, you can go back and listen to, if you care to listen to an episode about impeachment, we have a whole episode about impeachment discussion. It's essentially a political vehicle. And what you realize is that unless the party that is offering the impeachment
right.
articles is the power party and the party in power in Congress, then this is just going to be yesterday's news pretty quickly.
Absolutely, it will be. Though, if Republicans find out that Donald Trump really broke the law and he is hurting them at the ballot box, they will go against him as they did with Richard Nixon. And that's the thing. I mean, the Democrats controlled the House and the Senate during Nixon, and they still were able to force what looked like impeachment to the point where the president resigned.
And the Trump administration has lifted the ban on importing the heads of hunted elephants.
This is the ugliest story we've heard in a while, and it makes me think that, you know, we've joked about it, that Donald Trump has a list next to his bed of everything that Barack Obama did in his 8 years in office, and he's going through it one by one, fine-tooth comb, little things, big things, under the radar, on top of the radar, and just undoing all of it. And
yeah, because this was an Obama White House ban that was instituted in 2014. Elephants are a very fragile species on the endangered list, and these are trophy hunters. They go down to Africa, those who come home with these heads and tails and feet of all of these different creatures. And in that group of those trophy hunters, Donald Trump's sons, and they posted pictures.
Yeah, I know that Donald Trump Jr., there's a photograph of him with an elephant tail. It's some of the ugliest, most offensive stuff. I mean, to me, the person who does this, the president who reverses this, the child who goes out and kills an animal like this, to me, it's much worse than what he said to Billy Bush on a bus. This says more about what this guy is than even that. And I don't mean to be indelicate about it, but it's so offensive to me.
I don't think you can be indelicate at all about this. I think this is a dark heart.
Yeah.
This is a dark, dark heart.
Right. And I got to tell you, I grew up in New York City, right? And I don't speak for everyone who grew up in New York City, but to raise a trophy hunting hunter in New York City is a really tough thing to do. I didn't know anyone who did these sorts of things, and it's not like something that you're from the agricultural Midwest or you're from the Big Sky Mountain West, and those things might be, you might be more given to that if you're from the South, what have you. But you have to work very hard to raise a child in New York City who wants to go across the ocean and kill an elephant.
It feels like a rich guy thing that is mixed with some kind of dominion that you want over something. I don't know what. And it also feels as though it's a displaced machismo. You know, I was making fun of men earlier, but we have that, Michael. We have this machismo as a gender, right? And it manifests itself in different ways. And this is the ugly way it manifests itself.
Yeah, and man versus beast has always fascinated people. I mean, Hemingway made a lot of, you know, history and literature talking about that.
When Hemingway was writing, there were many, many elephants in Africa, and already the African elephant population, and there are Asian elephants also.
Yeah.
That population was depleted already. It was depleted by hunters. They went down there, and there were also indigenous hunters, of course.
Right.
But I'm talking about the sport hunters. They went down there, and they depleted the population even at Hemingway's time. Having said that, it's been depleted even more massively since. Why? Because of helicopters and because of infrared, and because these elephants are hunted relentlessly, and they don't care if they're with their calves, and they don't care what the state of the elephant is. They take them out for just trophies.
And also, there was a pirate ivory trade that informed a lot of that for a very long time. Is that you could get the ivory, you could sell the ivory for lots and lots of money on a black market, and it made people who had nothing wealthy.
And it's still, money still fuels all of this.
Yeah.
And the last thing, and we'll move on, I have a lighter thing to end with.
Lighter than that?
I want people to really understand what trophy hunters do. Trophy hunting is very much about hunting animals that have very limited space to run away. By the way, it's all bad, okay?
Right.
I don't mean to...
It's all rigged, too,
yeah.
right?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. And trophy hunting, and this is the kind of hunting that the Trump kids do. Trophy hunting involves shooting these creatures. They're often tigers. They're big game in a penned area, a limited area. Because why? Well, because rich fucks with big guns don't want to have to sweat. I mean, if they could just bring them into the dining room and they could shoot them dead, that they would do that.
Right.
And this is essentially what they do. Now, even if they're out there by the Chobe River, it's still a limited area. It's becoming a de facto penned in area. Why? Because their habitat is being consumed and destroyed by humans.
Right.
So they're slowly being penned in naturally. And so they have limited area to hide, limited area to run. And that, of course, tilts the favor toward the trophy hunter.
Yeah.
It's all pretty grim. I had one story, and then we move on. When I was in South Africa on a photographic safari, it's spectacular, of course. I heard a story of about an American trophy hunter from Texas. Not that it matters. Could be from anywhere. Clearly, as Michael says, they come from New York as well.
And I mean, the guy, the famous dentist in Michigan, right? Wasn't he the guy that killed that lion?
Sure.
You know, he was a dentist in Michigan.
And the guy wanted a cougar, I think it was, something like that. Yeah. Some kind of exotic creature. They got him one. They have it in a truck. Okay, it's in a panel truck, like a big panel truck.
Yeah.
Okay, like a moving truck. They open the back of the truck. The guy sticks the gun in, shoots it, and says, "All right, wrap it up for me. I'm going to talk to the guy who's been there for years." And because we were just talking about the changing ways, so this is the sort of person who goes down and hunts an endangered creature.
Right.
It could be that. It could be in the brush, but it's all serving the same misguided, obscene purpose.
You know, and the disturbed minds that kill serial killers, shooters. One thing that really ties a lot of them together is a joy of killing animals and the studies that have been done on these murderers. And so they're not far removed from Donald Trump Jr., who can get on a plane, fly first class, go across the world, and kill a beautiful animal. that isn't charging him or wanting to kill him.
Right.
You know, there's no self-defense here.
No, in fact, that animal probably would stay clear of a human
being. Most likely, yeah.
Leonardo da Vinci did a painting that wasn't even really well-regarded, I don't
think. It had mistakes.
Yet it is the most money that's ever been paid for a painting. $450.3 million.
Even the 0.3 to me is unbelievable.
Yeah, right. At that level, that 0.3 right.
You spent $300,000 on a fucking painting.
Exactly. That's exactly it. But what they were talking about as I was reading about this was the fact that it was a triumph of marketing.
Yeah.
That they said, this is your last chance to get a Da Vinci. And so it was Christie's auction house.
Right.
And
we never know the buyer, do we?
No, there were four main buyers.
Over the phone?
They said they had paddles up, so they were probably there. Yeah. I would think going on this one, you might want to be in.
No, very often the big ones are over the phone.
No.
Yeah, they're in, you know, other countries, or and they don't want it to be known.
They were pitching this painting in Hong Kong to rich Asian clients of Christie's. Right. And so they, you know, they try to seed the clouds of
exactly.
auction. Right.
Yeah. Well, that's what they do. I mean, power to them. I'm not critical of that.
Oh, not me either. Yeah. I know. I'm just trying to explain the general atmosphere that kind of fueled this frenzy. Because
I think
that's
it's
a
fascinating,
number.
Actually.
Yeah. Yeah. And one person at Christie's, I mean, like, you know, the guy who's the co-chairman of the old masters of Christie's, that department, he said, this is the most important old master painting to have been sold at auction in my lifetime.
He's got 9.
And they gave it a high-profile place. Again, this is just all the stuff. I didn't even think of this stuff, but they have an old master's sale.
Right.
But they didn't sell it there. They sold it in the contemporary sale because the contemporary sale tends to bring bigger numbers in.
I see.
And so there's just sort of like the game within the game.
Because the contemporary buyers don't want to be caught dead at an old master's auction.
This has been called the male Mona Lisa, said one person. Anyway, we'll have a picture of it on our website if you want to see it. Is that even necessary anymore? People just go on and they can just Google on their phone after we hear us talking about it.
I think both, but I think having it on the website right there,
yeah,
click away, is
we'll put it on the
nice
website.
See,
right? Yeah. It doesn't say who the buyer was. It says who the potential buyers were. You can learn all about
who are the potential buyers.
Well, there was one guy who's a Chinese billionaire.
Right. That's very often how it happens now, and that fluctuates. Russia was buying everything in the 90s and early aughts.
By the way, he was a former taxi driver.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, so that's kind of, again, you know, people say, well, you know, I come to America because it's the only place you can go from, the only place. Apparently,
stay home and you can look what happened.
Apparently, China, the guy didn't do badly. And there was also, I think, a Swiss
guy. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, the male Mona Lisa.
It was sold to Yves Bouvier for $80 million. That was in 2013. He's
and
a Swiss.
Yves Bouvier must be somehow related to the former first lady.
Oh, Bouvier, yeah, perhaps. Then he sold it. This Yves Bouvier, who bought it for $80 million, sold it for $127.5 million to the family trust of the Russian billionaire. Congratulations, Michael Shore. Dmitry Rybolovev. And then Rybolovev's family trust was the seller on Wednesday night. And they, having bought it for $127.5 million, sold it for, again, the cool sum of $450.3 million.
I wonder how it got to 0.3. Like, I mean, how? What? Why is it like a $449 million? All right, I'm going to go 450.3, and that's my final offer.
I have some Bed Bath and Beyond coupons. I will throw them into the mix if you'd like.
Hey, that's a big saving. That's like $90 million for one item, right?
That's right. That 20% off of $450 million is decent. If you want to talk to him, he's at Michael Shore. Shore is spelled S-H-U-R-E. Reach him on Twitter. Michael, you always bring us the truth, some perspective. Enjoy talking to you, and you put up with me and my maladroit attempts to explain what's happening in the world.
To my delight. This is great.
Love it. Michael Shore, everybody.
Oh, thank you all. And happy Thanksgiving to all of you, too. Happy Thanksgiving.
If you like The Edge, help us out by liking us on Facebook. Subscribe to The Edge with Mark Thompson on iTunes or on Stitcher. This is The Edge.
And now our conversation with one of the founders of one of the most successful bands in history, Three Dog Night. Comedian and performer Laura House joins me for this conversation with Chuck Negron. By the way, Laura has her own podcast, which is called Will You Med With Me, about meditation, but it also gets into all kinds of other subjects, so you may want to check that out. So Laura joins me for the conversation with Chuck Negron. Here is a bit, like just a random kind of cross-section, not in any order, of some of Three Dog Night's stuff through the years. Someone who has taken the greatest ride, founder of Three Dog Night, one of the most successful bands in history. They sold 60 million records. Chuck Negron also took this amazing ride through that kind of popularity, being a worldwide sensation in music. And then
cute, very cute.
And very attractive man. And then taking this huge
great
fall.
Legs.
Which was more fun?
Well, you know, I like being cute.
Yeah, nice, nice.
I should have led with cute.
None of it would have been fun without the cute.
He was a long-haired, mustachioed dude, lead singer, just this great, I mean, at the perfect time, late 60s, early 70s, and then, of course, you fall into heroin addiction and cocaine addiction. We're going to get into all of that. And then, what we all love, a rebirth.
Yes.
Phoenix.
You survived it.
Yes.
Which I still can't believe. Yeah.
I got a facelift, and I said, this looks good. I'm going to stop.
You know, Michael DeBar was...
Michael. Oh, I love Michael.
Okay, so Michael was on the show, and he said that he stopped, just funny of your facelift, he said he stopped doing drugs because he knew that it would ruin the way he looked.
Oh, wow.
He said, I did it for vanity. That's
the
why vanity I stopped.
Cure. Yeah.
The thing is, it did. No.
It's too late, Michael.
No. Michael's one of the funniest guys around. He's a very bright man.
Yeah, he's
a little booger.
He was a
no, I'm kidding.
But he's
adorable.
He is.
Him and Prince used to fight. Who was taller?
He's a diminutive fellow. Yeah. But when you talk about drug addiction, he was there also.
I used to hang with Michael from time to time.
Yeah, serious, serious problem. But you got into heroin addiction, and we'll get into that in a second. But before we get to that, I want to go back to when you were coming up, because you had an amazing rise, and you were quite a guy. I think you were a hoops player. Weren't you a college hoops player?
Yeah, that's how I got to California. I came out to California in 61 to go to college, and that's what I did. I was a ball player, but I sang, and by the time I went to Cal State, Bill Sharman, many of you might know Bill Sharman, he was the guard next to Bob Cousy for the Boston Celtics, and then he was the general manager of the Lakers, and then coached the Lakers. Hmm. But at any rate, I was on Columbia Records. I got a deal while in college, singing. I used to sing on the weekends, and that's when I made my break.
Chuck, weren't you a doo-wop singer originally?
Yes, at 15, I was in a group called the Rondells. And we had a little success, had a little record out there, and played the Apollo, which was a fascinating thing. Five
you
white
played the
guys,
Apollo as a teenager?
15 years old. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it was very frightening. Because when we came out, everyone was having a good time when they saw us. Ladies and gentlemen, the Rondells. You know, just silence.
Wait, are those what? Some little white kids?
Yeah. Get out of here. Go back to the Bronx.
Why are these babies trying to sing? Go home. Do your homework.
A fascinating thing happened. With about a second verse, they were rooting us home. And, you know, you learned something very powerful, because I was very scared. Because it's very obvious they didn't like us, they didn't want us there. Even the people backstage, the band, you know, it was like, oh, God, you know, they just didn't want us there.
That was a black-white thing, you're saying, or no?
Oh, no. Well, yeah, well, it was or their thing. Harlem was all black. We were the only white people for miles.
Sure, and here you come in with a doo-wop sound,
which
isn't exactly,
yeah, well,
you know.
They thought we were black. You know,
oh, I see. Okay.
And at any rate, when we started singing, they just music transcends all barriers.
Mm. Yeah.
And they just rooted us home, and it was a wonderful evening in the end. But I was very scared personally. It was kind of frightening for me. But I learned that music transcends everything.
That's so cool.
Yeah, that's a great story. It really is.
And I was cute.
You're what? 15?
Again.
You're really adorable.
You don't always want to play the cute card, but it helps to have it if you need it. Right.
Yeah.
So it was short-lived, that doo-wop thing.
Yeah, well, I left and went to college, and, you know, everyone went their own way. And, but a senior year in high school, you know, girls and, you know, girlfriend, boyfriend stuff. And I was playing ball, and that really became my primary goal, because I had no money to go to college. Our family, my mother couldn't afford it. So I knew I had to get a scholarship, and ended up I got some really nice ones. And so, you know, my hard work paid off.
I promise I'm going to get to the rock and roll and to this amazing ride. Before I get there, you mentioned your mom. I remember that, and correct me if I'm wrong, you had this as a little kid. You had a very rough time. You were given to a foster home, or you were, and then your mom took you back. I mean, I think she lost you and took you back.
No, what it was she couldn't take care of us. We were 7 and 8 years old, raising ourselves. My mother worked. She went to school because she knew she had to get a degree to get a job.
This is in New York City?
Yeah, especially, you know, in the late 40s, early 50s. I mean, you know, women had a different role than they do today. Was more defined, you know, in a not creative way at all. So she kind of made it her goal to make a better life for us all. But in the end, we got lost. So we had to go in. By the time I was 8, we were put in an orphanage. It was actually an orphanage. It was a pretty intense place. Military, you know, you marched everywhere. And it was very hard. I was nervous, and I wet my bed. Put a sign on me saying, I wet my bed.
Oh,
I walked around with a sign, I wet my bed, and sent me to school with it. You know, until one day this girl just ripped it off and said, don't you ever take this from anybody.
Oh, I love her.
Yeah, one of the older girls. You know, so it was a rough place. And there was a lot of stuff. You know, one of the people that watched us was a pedophile. And he had stuff going on with some of the kids. And I don't know where it came from. I think what it came from was fear. I was so afraid this guy turned him in. No one had said a word. I turned him in. I went in and turned him in. And they thought, you know, what are you talking about? They were like, they really, I was upsetting their world.
Yeah, sure, they shamed the kid.
They did not like me. And so they called my mother and asked if I lied and stuff like that. And actually, she didn't call my mother. They called her at work because we didn't have a phone, actually. Back then, we didn't have a phone.
Wow.
We didn't have a TV either.
You had no money.
No money. We had no money. So I stayed in that place for a couple of years. I think by the time we were 11, my mother had actually gotten her degree, had a good job.
Oh, wow.
And she was able to take you back.
And take us back, but we still didn't see her.
It was you and who, your sister?
My twin sister.
Yeah.
My twin sister. And we basically raised, well, my sister raised me. My mother was gone before we got up, and we went to bed sometimes before she got home.
Oh, it's a wild snapshot.
Different time, but it was hard. That orphanage taught me something that was good, but in a sense bad. I said, I'm going to become important enough not to get thrown away.
Mm-hmm.
I'm never going to put myself in a situation where someone can get rid of me. And I did that in everything I did. I was overachiever, basketball, singing, and I became very dependent. People became very dependent on me. And then I, you know, found out that's a curse, too.
Yeah.
Because when I, you know, I had a car accident, I broke my arm and my nose, and they arrested me because they thought I stole the car because I didn't look like a guy that could afford a brand-new Mercedes.
Mm.
And
when was that? I don't remember that story.
Oh, yeah, that was in 71. We were playing the Cotton Bowl. We'd sold out 80,000 seats. No one had done it. We sold out the Cotton Bowl. It was the first date of nothing but stadium tour. And I get in this accident. I break my nose, my arm. The police break my wrist because I take a swing at them. That's because they grabbed my broken arm. I was a tough guy. I didn't even know who it was. But I was. And so they roughed me up. And anyway, when I got to the hospital, my manager's there, took me right out and put me in a Learjet. The doctor's yelling, he could die. He has a concussion. And I realized I'm too important.
Wow.
I'm going to work no matter what happens to me. And I did. I got on the jet, Learjet, and we went, and I did the show. It was terrible. They have footage, actually, of it.
You played the Cotton Bowl, you're saying.
Yeah.
While you had this, whatever it was.
Oh, yeah, there's footage of it. I should get it to you. There's footage. It's on my DVD.
Okay.
One eye closed. Another one's just swollen in a cast.
Oh, my.
My hair's got blood in it.
That's so badass, though.
Yeah.
Like, you haven't seen Beyonce do that. Like, that is badass.
Yeah, okay.
That you is know, unbelievable.
And I want to let you know, I faded in and out all night, but I did it. I mean, I heard the tape, and I saw the video, and I went, oh, my God, I did all right. And actually, one of the guys, Corey, we do this three thing that, you know, the three of Corey sings, then Danny sings, then I sing.
Yeah, those are the three and three.
Yeah, and then after I sang, Corey just stopped and said, Danny, I have to tell you something. This guy has a broken nose. His eyes are closed, and he just wasted you.
That's a sick burn.
Yeah,
that's funny. That's so funny.
Hey, this guy in a lump in the corner. Yeah. He's still better than you.
Oh, that's so funny. It's such a simple song, sort of. It starts, but boy, that when you just even heard that keyboard at the beginning, it became an anthem almost. I mean, it was a biggest song for a long time.
Yes, and you know what? That's the magic of recording. You know, it doesn't what the sonics. All of a sudden, it's there, and you know, like all the songs you love. It's just that overall thing that just is magic, and that song had it, and you know, thankfully it was one of ours.
Yeah, well, and that was you singing lead there.
Yes, yes, yeah.
That's you. Wow.
Yeah, that's me as a young man.
Well,
super cute. you can hear the cute though, because you're almost like, I don't believe he's lonely.
Yeah.
He's too cute.
Well, it's my humble song.
No, it's coming from an honest place, but that guy's too cute.
You know, we're joking about the cute thing, but let me just say, I mean, at that time, okay, so when was it? The late 60s was one or 68?
68, I recorded it. 69, it became number one.
Okay, mm-hmm. So it's late 60s, and then you know, the Three Dog Night was into early 70s, mid-70s, and everybody's got now, there's a whole revolution going on in America, right?
Big time.
There's a civil rights revolution. There's a revolution the way people are dressing, the bell bottoms, the long hair, the kind of like, hey, we're not going to dress the way you straight button-down people want us to dress anymore. And who was the kind of poster child of that but you?
Well, I was one of them.
You had the long hair, the handlebar mustache, the big bell bottoms.
Yeah,
and you were
literally everyone wanted to look like you.
That's true. Yeah.
That's got to be. I've never had
fun.
That.
It was fun.
People have never been like, I got to dress like House. This is amazing.
It was an exciting time.
So
you would have dressed then back then. You would have worn all that stuff.
Oh, yeah. I would have.
You would have been on it. That's you with that incredible.
That's an octave and a half over the note.
Mm.
You have a 4-octave range, don't you?
Yeah. Well, I don't know if I have it anymore, but I did, and they were nice. When I got in my falsetto, it was just higher. I mean, they were nice. One night, I actually went up the whole neck of the guitar with my guitar player singing harmony.
Wow.
To his notes, and I was like, what? You know, I'm some kind of a dog freak here, you know. But anyway,
it sounds like based on kind of your background and stuff, you didn't go through any training or anything.
No, you know what I did when I got sober. I got sober in in 91. But before that, no, it was just, you know, it was a gift from God. It definitely was, because I had a range that there was just no end to it. And I didn't know where it came from. I didn't know if I was supposed to do it this way or that way. It just was something, you know, that was... It was in there, so I was very, very lucky. But I take voice now. It
seems like a cool discipline to maintain. You know?
Oh, it's wonderful. Yeah, it is. Especially if you want to take care of yourself and, you know, keep the quality. Because you can learn to sing to the point where you can hit the notes and do all the stuff, but it doesn't have that quality. You really have to work hard to make it sound pretty and make it sound nice.
I'm sure it's like a muscle, and as you get older, you got to work that muscle to kind of keep it.
You know what? Without a doubt. Yeah. You know, and when I'm working, it gets really big here. I mean, it's
in your throat.
In my throat. It probably does with you, too. Do you get a big singer? I mean, you have a muscle there?
I don't know. Maybe.
No. Well, you would know. You would know. Because I look like a frog.
You know, well, speaking of which. This is a live performance, I think.
Jeremiah was a bullfrog.
Wow, that's right on, too. Actually sounds like the record.
Yeah, I think you might be lip syncing this or something, huh?
Yeah.
No, but that's everybody lip synced back then. Like, well, if you couldn't lip sync, you weren't getting on a show.
Well, you know what? We'd go on shows and we'd bring the band. We'd go, look, could we check the sound here? Check the sound. You're just going to lip sync. Because they didn't have the facilities to mic a band. So we just started doing shows that did. And, we got known because we were much more exciting live.
Yeah, I did see some live performances.
Yeah,
so you did
a music scene. That right. show was a great show.
Right.
We did live stuff there.
That Joy to the World was another one, man. It was just everywhere.
Iconic.
Record of the year. One of these songs that had played so much you hated it. Yeah. You know what I mean? I was like, oh, please. I was embarrassed when it played.
But then also huge, like even those two songs, iconic for several generations.
Yes,
because the first one I'm like, oh, that song also so well used in Magnolia.
Yes.
And then that one I'm like, oh, The Big Chill. Like it wasn't, it was like,
and,
it's time.
In Gump, it was in Gump.
10 years later, 10 years after that, like amazing.
Yeah, it's been a real blessing, that song, because
that's so cool.
No one really, I picked that song because I didn't like the way Hoyt was being treated. Hoyt Axon, who wrote it.
I see.
Oh, really?
Hoyt brought it in. And the guys turned it down. I wasn't there, so I came in, and Joe said, you know, you should hear this. The guys turned it down, and he played it for me. And by this time, Boyd had changed it. So the one I heard was Jeremiah was a prophet, and I went, I don't think that's going to work. You know. So he wanted a gospel thing, and there were gospel singers in the back. And so anyway, one night I'm in the studio, and Hoyt comes in. And there's a bar right up the street. He was drinking a little. He came in and he said, you guys, I'm going to play this song again. And I was just there with the band, the other two. So he played a version of what Jeremiah was, you know, was a bullfrog. And, you know, I said, this could be really fun. Mm. Because I saw Joy to the World as something so positive. You know, we want so much joy, we want the fishes involved.
Yeah.
Right. You know? Fishes in the deep blue sea.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. So, and I thought that line, he kind of threw away the first line. It was, you know, he just threw it away. And I said, that's the line. So Michael and I found a key, some ridiculous key, D, that hurt. That's why it sounds like it sounds. And I just screamed it out. And we knew we had.
It's like the peg that the song hangs on, that first line.
Yeah, well, that line he wrote. I mean, yeah.
Also, as a kid, I remember when I first heard
it.
Because as a kid, you're like, who sings about a bullfrog? Like, you're like 11.
Yeah.
And that's just what you see. Yeah. Like, it was, amazing.
Yeah, it's a great line.
There's also, again,
it's hilarious.
At that time,
why did you name a bullfrog and why Jeremiah? There's so many questions.
Yeah, it's so stupid and crazy, and yet it so works, right?
And you just want to yell it. So great.
At that time, too, that Joy to the World, and again, we're coming out of the Vietnam. We're in the Vietnam War at that time.
Terrible war.
And people, there are protests across America, and their civil rights movement is gaining tremendous momentum. The inner cities are just these kind of boiling pots of rage and resentment.
Angry and boiling up, literally, too, because, you know, the summers are terrible, and these these people, you know, all over America, white, black, Hispanic, had no money. You know, things were hard. Things were hard. And there definitely was the middle class then really did well. They, you know, they did well, but below it, and then, of course, above it, they... No, they had
There's never been a problem, yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
That's
But I guess what I'm trying to say is that joy to the world, that love, peace, that message was beginning to get into the zeitgeist more. So yeah, I feel like it might sound like joy to the world. It's like a, it's a popish kind of fun song on one level, but on another level, it sort of resonated. And I think you did Easy to Be Hard, didn't you?
Yeah. But let me just put one thing on this.
Yeah.
What you just said is, you know, is right. And I had an epiphany on this. On this song, because I really didn't understand why it was huge. I mean, 12 million records. I mean, it was insane. You know, I mean, some people don't have a career with 12 million records. We'd say that was one
right, in an entire lifetime.
I was in Hawaii on Maui when there was nothing on Maui. And there was a boat coming by with these people singing. It was all, you know, tourists, and they were singing Joy to the World. And I went, hey! That's me. No, I didn't. I just went.
Who's that cute guy yelling at us?
I went, and they started making fun of me. Oh, you freak. Blah, blah.
Yeah.
And I went, they think I'm a freak, but they don't think that song comes from a freak.
Yeah.
This song has crossed over to very normal people who now can get peace and love and joy when they didn't get any of the other stuff.
Wow. That's wild. And, you know, thank you for reminding me of something. If you looked a certain way back then, they considered you a hippie, or they considered you a revolutionary, or they considered you a commie, or they considered...
Oh, yeah.
And I'm sure we still do that now to a certain extent, although
well,
I think it's much broader.
People profile is a natural instinct.
And it's funny, those songs were so big. I associated Three Dog Night as a kid with Chuck Negron. Yeah. I didn't know at all. I was just a little guy. There was no internet, nothing. But I just remember, as a consumer of just listening on the radio, it's that guy with the long hair and the mustache. He's Three Dog Night, right? Yeah. But it was, as you say, slowly it came together as the other guy.
Exactly. Very fascinating, not a fascinating thing, an awkward thing happened. Because I had the first two real hits, I was doing a lot of TV. My face was out there. All of a sudden, some tension, you know, in the band. And look, I played basketball my whole life. I lived in an orphanage. Mm. You help one another. So I didn't understand. I didn't understand how they didn't see this is the whole deal. We're together here. And it got really hard. And awkward for me. Not all, it got difficult for me. And then Corey came out with Mama Told Me Not to Come. And the idea of the band, the three lead singers, was almost done because Corey now was number two.
Era's coming. Era's coming. A broken heart. Eli's coming, hide your heart, girl. Eli's coming, hide your heart, girl. Girl, Eli's are coming, you better hide, girl. Eli's are coming, you better hide, girl. Eli's are coming, you better hide, girl. Eli's coming, hide your heart, girl.
Hide it, you better hide your heart.
Eli's coming, better walk.
And it just got so much better. And then Danny came out with Black and White and number one, and it was realized. But it really takes time for things to get where you want them to go because the public picks what they want.
Sure.
A child is black, a child is white. The whole world looks upon a sight, a beautiful sight. And now a child.
Broadway musical Hair came out, mm-hmm. and then that Easy to Be Hard.
Yes.
That was a... That
second
was a,
number one. That actually was a number one on Record World. Number 2 in Cashbox and I think number 5 in Billboard. Another one just went through the roof. And great song, great song. Did that in one take.
Oh, wow.
I have to brag on myself.
You can hear a little bit of it. It's in it.
How can people be so heartless?
Listen how sweet you sound.
Well, you know, it's, so I'm pretty sweet.
I'm pretty sweet.
You're channeling your sweet, right?
You can't tell?
So you're saying this song was actually, even though it was in the Broadway musical Hair, wasn't it?
Yeah, but with the way they did it was, they missed. Of course, for Broadway it worked, but the way they sang it, it never worked on a record because they went, "How can people be so happy? How can people be so cruel? Easy to be hard." Right. And I took that breath, easy. You know, just it's easy. You know, people have no problem being dicks. You know?
That was the working title for the song.
That'd be my song. Yeah.
People have no problem being dicks. Right.
Easy being a dick. In the Trader Joe's parking lot, everybody calm down. We're just trying to get some almond milk. You're a dick. I'm a songwriter. I'm a bit of a songwriter.
Where's the? This is another. This is later, I feel like.
Yes, this is our next. One of the last singles. Great song, written by John Finley, who was in the group called Rhinoceros. I don't know if you know, but they big push. They were really good. They didn't make it. But boy, were they good. And he wrote this song, and that's Corey. Unbelievable. Corey's one of the great Greek singers.
Yeah.
I mean, I've worked with a lot of singers. Never worked with anyone as good as him. And that's one of the loves I had for Three Dog Night. You didn't get a night off because of him.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, because he was...
just setting the bar so high.
Oh, and plus, he went to bed. Yeah. He got up, he went fishing. He's a world-class fly fisherman. He's writing articles. I go, what is that? He's like, writing an article for Field and Stream. I went, oh, don't tell anybody that.
Was this song pretty big, too, for you guys?
I've never been to Spain.
Gold record, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great, great song.
But I kinda like the music.
Yeah, this is a top 5 record.
Yeah.
See the ladies.
Lord, did you ever hear any of this? You heard this, yeah?
I'm not super familiar with this.
And they should know how to use it.
And I'm playing a few of these in a row to kind of establish that you're riding a real wave. Of,
yeah,
okay,
we're
this, top
this
five.
I think came after Old Fashioned Love Song.
Just an old fashioned love song. Playing on the radio and wrapped around the music is the sound of someone promising they'll never go. You swear you've heard it before as it slowly rambles on.
With Old Fashioned, which was a million seller and was number one on Record World, and back then they had MOR or Middle of the Road,
sure,
and Adult Contemporary, and it was also one on those charts. And then this came out and really gave us a little funkier, you know. We had the ability to do something really pretty like Old Fashioned, and then boom, you know,
right?
Because
exactly.
He takes off on this.
Yeah, a little bit later in the song, he really just gets.
Well, I've never been to heaven.
What does it matter?
passed about 3 years ago.
I know, so sad.
Yeah.
So sad.
Yeah, one of those, the chemo, everything was working. He was getting ready to go back to work. He went home and he got a staph infection.
Oh, God.
So he's going to make it, except, that, you know, he's so vulnerable.
Yeah.
And they sure know how to use it.
Oh, they mean their lady parts.
Yeah.
I mean, they're gonna. I like to break down songs.
Lady parts didn't rhyme.
They know how to use it.
Yeah,
use their lady parts, Laura. That doesn't. That's not rhythmic. It's not anything.
So during this time, Three Dog Night, as we've said, we played a few of these songs and love this music, and it's the music I grew up with. It's weird, and you're right about the transcendental nature of music. You know, like I knew you were coming in, so I started sort of collecting the music, and I started listening to it, and it's moving almost. They're all up songs, or many of them are up, and yet somehow inside me, I feel all those things of being a kid and pressures and problems of being a kid. Of course, I had no problems compared to being in an orphanage.
But I think music makes even those experiences better.
Yeah, but it's evocative. You understand what I mean? It brings me back on
without
some
a
level.
Doubt.
So it's powerful.
Yeah. Music is, you know, music. I mean, to me, when I heard it, it made my hair stand up, and I went, you know, I was too young for even a girl to do that, you know. So it'd be years from this. This is cool. Yeah,
You did it. How old were you when the song One hit, which is your first big hit with Three Dog Night?
25.
Okay, 25.
Yeah,
so
a lot of these guys were younger than us that were coming up. They were like 3 years, 2 years. They were boomers. We were a little past the boomers.
Oh, huh.
And then it all just, this floodgate of hit records came.
21, yeah.
And you were on television. Your song was on the radio everywhere.
Yeah.
I'm talking about whatever song it was. It was One. It was Old Fashioned Love Song. It was
Joy to the World.
Joy to the World. Thank you. And unlike today, the radio stations then were sort of funneling the world of music into top 40. That was by far the most popular format.
Yes.
So you went into a store, you didn't hear some electronic dance music and kind of a house mix. No, 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 no. You heard Joy to the World or One or whatever. You heard pop
and
music.
And Masekela and, you know, the Beatles. I mean, it was unbelievable how eclectic it was.
Right.
Like, we did a show, James Taylor, Led Zeppelin, Three Dog Night.
Stop it.
You're not going to get that today.
No.
You know, I mean, it's like, that's how it was. And that's why the festivals were so huge.
Oh,
because
yeah.
That's where they were, that. It was. To 10th degree. It was everybody.
Yeah, it wasn't 10 bands that sound the same.
Yeah, no, it's all, they were just totally all, you know, Linda Ronstadt, you know, and then Chaka Khan, you know, just.
Oh, my God.
Just, you know, of course, Jimmy headlined most of them. He was so big.
Jimi Hendrix?
Hendrix, yeah. I'm sorry. Yeah. Hendrix, yeah.
Just because you mentioned Hendrix, he was really like super edgy, underground, but also mainstream. In other words, everybody knew him.
Yeah.
What was it like being around him? Who was he?
He's an interesting guy because he is someone that you wouldn't think about the road he took, okay? He took very young. He worked with the... a lot of the R&B acts. He played with the Isley Brothers. He played guitar. Mm. Played guitar for a lot of the Motown acts. Then he went into the Air Force. I mean, he was in the service.
You never hear that.
Yeah, he was in the service.
And the Air Force wasn't a band. You mean
he was in there. He was
that ripping band.
You know,
the
and
Air
then
Force.
He came out and he went back to the soul stuff. But then he realized, you know, he wanted to do something different. And when he went to England, and everyone was blown away by what he did. He hadn't even made it then. They made that first record, Jimi Hendrix Experience, was in England, and he came and it all exploded. He always wanted to be more mainstream. Him, Janis. Why can't I have hits like you guys, or like these guys, you know? And it was fascinating, but because there was no one editing their songs into 3-minute things or taking the heart out of them.
Right.
They lived the way they were supposed to, and that eliminates some listeners.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
But they did well. I mean, they were, you know, big, big acts, without a doubt. And iconically, in the long term, they're probably selling. I know Jimmy's selling more records than probably anyone these last 40, 50 years.
Mm. Yeah. No, you're right.
Janis does too, I'm sure. But he was shy off stage. Yeah, he was shy. You would never think he would be there. He jammed with us once, came out and said, can I play?
Oh, that's so cool.
No, I'm sorry, man.
No, yeah. Get out of here. No,
go shave and brush your teeth.
We're a full band, all right? But that's also like, so, sorry to make it about me moment, but my boyfriend is a jazz trumpet player. So we were just at the Monterey Jazz Festival, he was on the same stage where Jimmy had played. I'm sure you played at the Pop Festival, I would guess.
No, never did.
Oh, never did.
No.
But they there's such a thing with musicians where I could see them doing that of like, oh, so-and-so joined us from the other stage. We worked together earlier. And it's such a... Because as a viewer, as an audience member, you're like, oh, that guy I love is going to play with this band. You're like, this is not going to happen again.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. No.
This, what a neat special
but
thing.
But that's what respect and music does.
Yes. And the like, how it all comes together in that moment. And you can tell, like, I'm just in my mind imagining if I was sitting there and I got to see Three Dog Night, and you were like, oh, Jimi Hendrix is sitting with us. And he would be like, well, I'm just going to lose my mind right now. And my brain just popped out of my head. Oh, that's cool. That's cool.
Do you mind if I sit in?
Right. Somebody's such a virtuoso.
Somebody's a show.
And he moved like a ballerina.
Wow.
That move, it was so sexy. Excuse me. But he moved was just very, very special. Yeah. He was a star.
So that look of Three Dog Night is so iconic that when I was doing comedy, started comedy in the 90s, the bartender had that look.
Yeah,
and
we
called him Three Dog George. Because that
is that right?
Yeah, you were just like, no, that's the look.
That's really good. Three Dog Night was on top of the world. In fact, we were talking about the record sales alone, and they're overwhelming. They're not comparable to anything today. Like if you think of Beyonce or Bruno Mars or someone like that, these are gargantuan artists, right? Worldwide sensations, and they have not sold the kind of records
sold. You know, not to this point. I know Beyonce, I don't know, she's coming up around 30. A million, and then they're figuring in what the downloads are too. But that's like one tune; it's not an album, so you can't. Mm. You can't. It's how do you measure that? But anyway, it's amazing the
disparity
between back in the day, and then you take the Eagles, and there's no one even close to what these guys did, and we did real well. You know, we're real well set. There's an argument going that we sold 60 back then, that we've sold around 85, 90 now. But since we weren't paid for 89, 90.
Really?
Yeah. We were paid for 60. Those that say that they weren't sold, and you know,
I see. So in other words, there's some creative accounting.
Yeah. Because that's because they're also honest. Of course, we're mistaken.
Yeah.
We mentioned 18 consecutive top 20 hits, 21 top 40 hits, 8 top 10 hits, 4 number 1 hits, 5 top 10 albums, 11 top 20 albums. So this is an insane amount of success for anyone to handle. And indeed for you, it was too much to handle. You really got into indulging everything at the time. Now, at the time, to be fair to you, that sex, drugs, and rock and roll world had sort of been romanticized, but you really were sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
Well, you know, I was very naive. I was very clean. I was sober. I didn't drink in college. I didn't smoke. I was an athlete.
Yeah,
a world-class athlete.
Right.
And so when, you know, I was told by Columbia, you need to leave school. You know, you can't miss all these sessions because you got a game. Come on. You know, so I left school. And when they started taking me to parties, you need to go to this party. Big record companies do that, you know. Mm-hmm. And I started seeing people I really respected. Every one of them getting high.
Yeah.
Every single one of them. And one day I was at a party for Donovan, and that's where I met Danny Hutton from Three Dog Night. And these girls said, "You want to get high?" And I said, "Yes."
Today's the day.
I'm ready.
The right people were pitching.
I'm ready. You know, I'm a virgin.
I feel safe with Donovan. That meditation guy.
Yeah.
What could go wrong with you with Donovan?
And I was like, a bomb ready to go off because for me, I was shy, I was quiet. And once I got that drugs, it was like bing, bang. Mm. Hi, I'm Chuck. You know, I became Anthony Stunning.
Anthony Stunning. You know I'm cute. I don't have to tell you.
So, it you know.
Was that pot or was it coke?
No, the coke came the next day. No, coke. It was a pill. I think it was some kind of psilocybin. The psilocybin type thing.
Mushroom.
Mushroom.
A little hallucinogenic.
And it was nice. And then I met Danny.
At the same party for
at
Donovan.
At the same party.
With Donovan.
We got together, him and his girlfriend and me, and his friend, who was his producer. And we talked, and he said, hey, do you want to get some? I said, you know, we know Osley, the guy who makes it. I don't think I could do that. They said, well, you took is almost the same thing. So I went, okay. So we went there, and we got the original real deal, the blue. And it was...
Wow.
It was unbelievable. It was beautiful, man.
What is acid like, taking it?
Well...
Just to, again, to set the time, because I don't think now you don't hear much about it, but at that time, the acid experience was this mind-expanding experience. It was considered very dangerous by a lot of people.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong, but it was also considered that...
Expanding.
Yeah, what was his name? Timothy Leary,
Timothy
right?
Leary, yeah. He pushed it big time.
Anyway, go ahead. So
but
what
people
was it?
Don't know, Cary Grant was on LSD therapy.
Very much, yeah.
And, you know, he said it changed his life. So in controlled environments... It was very powerful, but it was a very powerful drug.
What was it? What was the experience
like?
Well,
for me, we started driving down Sunset Boulevard to head out to the beach, and I turned my head, and the whole block came with me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I went, oh, you know, that's great. So I spent the next hour doing
just looking around.
No, just getting woom, woom, woom. And then we went to the beach, and the ocean was the most powerful thing, the most humbling thing. I was just this little... piece of sand that was so just so powerful. And
hey, you don't have to tell me.
Yeah.
I'm not asking. I know what acid's like. It's amazing. Yeah. And it like melts what are your limiting adult perceptions of the world. Like where you're like, oh, we have to drive, these are the rules, we have to drive all the sort of things that we take for granted to get through the day. Because you can't, that's why you can only do acid sometimes, because you wouldn't be able to walk. It's like if you're having a, like, day 100 of a spiritual retreat on the mountain and just blown away by the unity of everything and the oneness and nature's here for us and we're part of it and it's part, like, you can't live like that every day.
No, you can't.
But that's what acid just has this, like, oh, I'm part of everything and this is, it's amazing.
It is. It was.
Okay. Now.
And then, let me tell you, that day, though, when I'm feeling like this, the guy next to me is going, the sand is eating my feet.
Right. There's a
paranoia. Well, you don't want to be with that guy.
No, but there's a paranoiac difficult.
Yeah, and
people,
and he
people
was
have taken
on,
their own
he
lives.
He was on a bummer. We had to leave.
That's where the term bummer comes from.
Yeah. So.
But not everybody.
No, not
everybody.
It was
a bum trip.
Bum trip.
But, like,
exactly.
I never had that.
Yeah.
Like, there are some people aren't good at it.
I had it once. I was sitting around. It was kind of a weird situation happened. The girl I was with, our ex-boyfriend walked in.
Wow. Oh,
and he was kind of in a weird place, and I kind of went,
Yeah.
That's a bum trip
and
already.
I immediately went, I want to die. You know,
oh, wow.
No, you know, and then Tim, my guy, my friend, just, Jeff, go outside.
Yeah.
And I did, and next thing I know.
Yeah, look at the stars.
Yeah.
Look at the stars for 4 or 5 hours.
And it was just wonderful.
But what happened was an awful slide into total drug addiction. You became a heroin addict.
Yep, yep.
And a coke addict. You became someone who lost his career. You lost everything.
Well, you know, the interesting... Well, as far as the career... Yeah, I
mean, at the time.
No,
I understand
did,
you rebuilt
but what,
your career.
Because I don't want to minimize anything. But little by little, and it seems so innocent... someone gives you a hit of coke, and you're like, you know, I remember the first time, to be honest, guys give me a hit of coke, and I'm going, you know, I don't get it, this doesn't work, I don't feel anything, I don't know what's the big thing with the stuff, I don't get it, I simply don't get it. And he,
yeah. That sounds like a guy who just did a line of coke.
Yeah, and he goes,
why is everything going so slow?
So anyway, I couldn't sleep.
I need another four.
Danny said, here, take this. And I took a downer.
Yeah.
I loved the downers. I bought 5,000. Danny and I split 5,000.
Jesus Christ.
It came in a pillowcase.
Were you expecting
and
company, or what was the story?
And at no point were you like, you think I have a problem?
No,
and
no.
You're like,
and I had a problem from day one.
Yeah.
I just wanted it all, and I wanted it now. And then the bad thing was when I went from the cocaine and the pills, I realized I couldn't take these pills anymore. I was going to kill myself. Mm-hmm. So I stopped the pills. And one day this guy said, hey, you want some of this? And I'd been asked to do it hundreds of times. Not hundreds of times, many times. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for whatever reason, I said, sure. And I was going through a divorce. Maybe that's the reason, but I really don't know. And I took it, and it's like the most unbelievable euphoric feeling I've ever had. And from that day on, I didn't want to ever be without it.
And I'm sorry,
the heroin?
That was the heroin.
Heroin, yeah. And yeah. It ruined. I stopped doing coke. I stopped doing everything, and became strict, heroin addict. And that went on from the mid. About 73 to 91.
So
lost everything.
So the truth is, in 1973, just to reset it, you were part of Three Dog Night, still crushing it. You guys still were pumping. So here you are, top of the charts, this incredible rock star, and yet you're absolutely addicted to heroin. And everybody in the band must know it.
Yeah, well, Jimmy was too, the keyboard player. He was too, so I had an ally. You know, we covered each other's back, and we got methadone. We went on methadone programs so we could bring methadone out. So we were always functional. We were always...
Heroin addicts can be amazingly functional, is understanding. Like, even moms and stuff. Like, you can ration it and keep it together. Oh, yeah. I'm told, that's amazing.
My mother once said to me, and she said, you know, you're so good. I mean, I would never know you're on heroin, you know. And I
gave it a kick.
I go, Mom, what do you mean? She said, well, you know, one day I was saying to you, you know, you're on heroin and you're lying right in my face. And I said, yeah, Mom. She said, you know what you said to me? Yes, Mom, but hear me out.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow.
Insane. You're right. I'm lying. But listen, this is good.
Here's why that needed to happen.
My mother then never got over it. I mean, when I was even clean, when she passed away, I was probably clean 15 years. And she never really trusted me.
I see.
You know? But she was a tough cookie. You know, you kind of, if you messed up with her, it was hard to redeem yourself.
During the time that you're an addict, all kinds of wild stuff happened. And I read this book called Three Dog Nightmare. Okay, and it's all about, and you wrote it with Chris Blatchford.
Yeah, great guy.
And Chris is a guy I've known for years, and that's kind of one of the reasons I picked the book up. And you cannot put this book down, because it takes you through a lot of what we've talked about here today. And then it takes you through these experiences that you had on heroin or whatever addiction you were manifesting at that moment. You were pulled over by the cops. You were worked over by the cops. You passed sobriety test, then you didn't pass sobriety test, and the cops pulled you in. All kinds of bad shit happened to you. I remember at one point, this has to do more with the sex part of your... It was a decadence, is the point, though. There was a decadence to this. And because you were a rock star...
And cute,
you were having sex with people all the time. And at some point, your private parts were getting to the point that they were abraded, and you know, your penis was literally like
engorged.
Yeah, and it was. So you go to the doctor and you say, "Hey, listen, I'm worried. You know, I am." And of course, he's like, "Yeah, Jack Negron, you're the greatest. You know, I've seen you on the cover of Newsweek and Time magazine this week." And he goes, "Yeah, you're this just in. You cannot have sex. You cannot use that penis for 2 weeks. You've got to let it
rip. Blood's got to come out."
And what do? That night, you got a show, and of course, you're a rock star.
Yeah.
And all the women are throwing themselves
at you. Well, actually, it was Miss Oklahoma.
Oh, was it?
And she was just so sweet. You know, she's so special. Nice, and she didn't know anyone like me.
And
oh, my God.
And so you couldn't resist, and you had sex with her,
yes,
Miss Oklahoma.
Sorry, Amy.
And the doctor had warned you, if you have sex, your penis is going to explode because you've got these blood vessels that need to. And just as the doctor said, you look down and what? There was blood everywhere.
First it was like Psycho. You hear it. And then, this is terrible. There's blood everywhere. And she's screaming, you know.
No, it's an insane story. It's in the book.
And I'm going, don't worry, it's me. She goes, I know it's you. What is it? So I call my road manager. He rushes me to the hospital.
Right, and now you've got, in the book you describe, your towels that you're putting there in front of, and they're just filling with blood. There's so much blood coming out.
And then finally you get that stopped. They rush me in, and they're looking they're looking at it, and they're going, you know, you're going to need, 15 or more stitches. I go, oh my God. And they go, but we'd like someone else to look at it. And a bunch of doctors and nurses come in. And they're going, huh, I see. And they're starting to laugh.
Wow, that's so wrong. That's so wrong.
And they go, so what happened? Some of them can't keep it straight. Well,
what happened was I joined a band called Three Dog Night, yeah, right? And we've sold a bunch of records.
You know, so at any rate, I found out a lot what it had. And it damaged me. What it had was the nerves. It had so engorged, got so large. I like that. But it got so large that it ruined some of the nerves.
Yeah.
And the blood could not get out.
But imagine sitting there in the ER, having been through this, knowing that you shouldn't have, but you violated a doctor's orders. And then what happens? Everybody recognizes you as the lead singer of Three Dog Night.
Oh, yeah, they're having a lot of fun with
it. I mean, and that's the anonymity there.
And right. And it's not like you just have a hemorrhoid or something, I mean, which is sort of like one of those, like,
or a gerbil up my ass.
You know, well, but right. Yeah. This is
dick exploded inside Miss Oklahoma.
Yeah, that is a wild brag. Yeah.
I heard she became a drug addict.
Yeah.
Never recovered. No, I'm kidding.
Now, but that's the sex
you
part.
You would want to try to get that.
That's the sex part of it. And that has the decadence. So we've talked about the drug part and the decadence. You ultimately were dropped from Three Dog Night because of the...
Interesting thing. In this book, when we'll get to that, I wrote 11 more chapters. I clarify what happened just because when I initially wrote this book, I wanted to bear the burden of everything I did according to me. I didn't want to put anything on anybody else. I wanted people to see the damage this thing's done. And if I qualified anything, I felt, it wouldn't have the impact that it did writing the way. But in fact, I gave Three Dog Night their first million seller. Mm. I gave them their last million seller. When it was almost over, Show Must Go On, last million seller.
What was their last million seller?
Show Must Go On.
Show Must Go On. Oh, yeah, that's
I gave them
song.
The first top 40, top 10 record. I gave them the last top 40 record. Till the World Ends. Well, Danny was already gone. It was just Corey Mean and Jimmy left. And then Corey and I got into a fight, and we decided, this is too much. The band's, and we ended in the Greek Theater. But I ended in that band. What happened was, in the 80s, they wanted to do a reunion.
Oh.
I was a full-blown heroin addict. I was in the hospital with hepatitis C. Mm. They came, and they, you know, we're going on the road. We got a tour. You got to do it. If you don't want to do it now, you're losing your rights. My father was there. I couldn't tell my father, Dad, I'm a heroin addict. I can't do this. Mm. So she said, sign the contract, son. Come on. We're going to do this. I'll help you. And I couldn't break his heart, and I did, because I knew I couldn't do it. But I lasted 5 years.
Oh, wow.
I lasted 4 years, from 81 to almost 86.
That's
December
impressive.
Of 85. And then I went into rehab, and I said, it's over. They didn't fire me. I left. But the point was, when the band was a viable thing, I was still in it. So, but people have that opinion, that thought that I did it. But I don't mind if they do, because I think that's part of what I want them to think.
Sure. In other words, in a way, it helps your story,
exactly.
Which is to keep people away from these drugs, which are so toxic.
Yeah.
And if you understand that the toxicity was so bad that it even destroyed my relationships, professional relationships, with continuing with the band, it's okay.
And,
even though it's kind of not quite accurate.
Most guys, and this, I'm not patting myself on the back, I was just stupid, but most guys aren't as resilient as me, physically as strong as I am. I was an athlete.
No, your doctor said, I can't believe you're alive.
Yeah,
that's
that
over and over in your book. I can't believe you're even surviving this.
And so at any rate,
It's unreal. So then the post Three Dog Night era, for a small period of the 80s, you're saying there was kind of a reunion thing. And then you had to you went into rehab and you had to reconstitute yourself. I don't know how you do it. You'd lost it all pretty much.
I had nothing. I got out of rehab and slept on my sponsor's couch. Mm. I slept on my sponsor's couch.
I mean, where did all those
My wife, who became my ex-wife, had the cars. I had nothing.
Where was all the money?
We'd spend all the money. I mean, we were living from royalty check to royalty check.
How do you spend that much money, Chuck?
Well, you're stupid. You know. Well,
so how does that stupidity?
You get taken. Okay, here's a terrible example. Danny, Corey, and I built a condo, 4-story in Beverly Hills. Elevators in certain condos had their own elevators.
Mm.
I mean, on Stanley, I think, right off of Beverly, and I sold my interest for $75,000. I mean, we're talking $35,000. Because that's all I could get, and the guy, you know, that was it. You put in $25,000, I'll give you an extra $10,000. This thing was millions and millions of dollars. And I waited as long as I could to see if I could get some, and I couldn't, so I just took the money.
Because you needed the money for drugs? Or
yeah,
what?
Yeah, for drugs.
But
when you start using drugs, you're using thousands of dollars a day. I mean, I got to the point I was doing enough to literally kill an elephant. Because you either die or your tolerance gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And mine, I was doing with my wife, my ex-wife now, a quarter ounce of heroin a day. A day.
What does that cost?
Oh, that's probably, at that point, probably $3,000 a day.
Mm.
That's in $1,980.
I have a friend who's sober, and I'm sober, and when he does an anniversary, he says, you know, he's like, I'm 26 years sober, I had a $2,000 a day heroin habit, so I saved, he always puts it in the, one way to look at it is the minutes or the seconds or the days. But one way to look at it is the money. I have not had this amount. I mean, obviously, it would have inflated and it would have, you would have taken more. But it's like, when I stopped, it was $2,000 a day. And
it's a ridiculous amount of money. Yeah.
You say something in your book, I remember, which was, because I'd always thought this, which is people ask me, how come you don't just stop? I mean, at some point, can't you see all these things that you just talked about—the Beverly Hills thing
and a non-addict?
Hospital.
You say to them, you might be putting, your skin might be bad. Why don't you just take care of better care of your skin now? You know, or whatever the example
or the
is.
Weight, or
weight's a good one,
right? Because everybody's struggling a little bit with some kind of dietary thing, you know.
Yeah, well, everyone struggles with something, and they can't translate it. We all have a cross to bear, and people can't stop what they can't stop. But so don't get it. But addicts are different, and alcoholics are different. We have, we have this obsession of the body and mind that this is relentless, and the only way to stop is to keep us away, be clean for long enough, so the obsession and physical craving is gone, and then not do it again.
Now you can be around it, and alcohol, for example.
I'm
not going to take it to
But Amy doesn't smoke a drink or anything. I went into a hospital once, and this guy said, come here, is this crack? And he's showing this stuff, and I'm going, you really shouldn't, this is not really good. And he goes, I just want to know. And I said, and then the next thing I know, I'm picking it up.
Yeah.
And I'm going, no, this is soap. Kid was selling soap.
Oh, my God.
Just like crack.
That's
crazy. Looked just like crack. But, he gave it, and I found myself picking it up.
Yeah. Of course, being interested. Yeah. But that's also...
I had a soap addiction for a short time.
Oh, yeah. That's the thing. You can't be around.
Yeah, that's why I smell the way I do.
Because
I can't be around the soap anymore.
I totally get it.
No, girls from Oklahoma is my thing.
No, there's no...
That's a wild story.
I mean, if you can't resist...
So, now you're actually touring again, and you got an album. So, give us a quick sense of where people can keep up with Chuck Negron.
I've been touring for the last several years.
Oh, wow.
I don't know, 5 or 6 years with the Happy Together Tour. Mm-hmm. Which is
Classic rockers.
Classic rockers. It changes each summer. This coming year, we have the Cow Sills, who, by the way, are great.
Really?
You'd be surprised.
Now, the Cow Sills had what?
Hair.
Uh huh.
And
of course.
And the Park thing. What's the one?
Yeah, Cow Sills had a couple of hits.
They were big. The harmony's unbelievable.
Yeah. Gary, the Partridge Family was kind of based on the Cow Sills.
Totally based on them. Yeah. Matter of fact, the Cow Sills had the gig. And they decided they wanted to go with actors, but they were going to do it on them. Let's see, we have Gary Puckett.
That was my first concert ever seeing Gary Puckett. I was the little guy. And the Union Gap, right?
The Union Gap, the Union Gap. They'll be there. Who else do we have? Mark Lindsay.
Oh, yeah. And
the Turtles.
Cherokee Nation.
The Box Tops. The Box Tops were there this summer.
That's wild.
The Association. They're good, too.
So where can people see all that? Go to your website, chucknegron.com. That's the best place probably to find all the information. chucknegron.com. It's the official site for all Chuck Negron news, and you can get updates on the tour. Oh, and I found one thing, and we'll close with this, Chuck Negron. You have a shop. You probably don't even realize this on your website. You have a shop where I can buy things that are Three Dog Night and Chuck Negron related. For example, there are vintage 8x10s of you, that handsome devil with the long hair and the mustache, or you with the other band members, or Chuck Negron, the classic face on a Christmas ornament. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yes, I have actually seen I've seen these.
I must have this.
You want a Christmas ornament?
Oh, these ornaments are great.
I must have a Chuck Negron Christmas ornament. Listen, I don't appeal to the audience much for them to give me something, but this Christmas, I want to check Negron Christmas Ornament. It would be so great. And I've got your book, the original book. I can't wait to read the updates. You have 11 new chapters or something?
Yeah, 11 new chapters, and I'm very excited about this new, you know, new information. Some pretty intense stuff in there. And then some wonderful good stuff.
Again, that's called Three Dog Nightmare. It's all on Chuck's website, chucknegron.com. Chuck, thank you for joining us. Yeah, a lot of fun.
Chuck, great meeting you.
He's cute. Yeah.
So heartless, how can people be so cruel, easy to be proud, easy to say no, easy to be cold, easy to say no, come on, easy to give in.
First of all, you know, it's great to be on the show with all of you and all that and all these things. I love it. And if you enjoy listening to The Edge, subscribe to The Edge on iTunes, the Stitcher, and you can totally listen to it on iHeartRadio.